You don't normally think of simple, everyday items like, say, a pretzel being the result of screws. I mean, sure, the machines that make pretzels have screws in them used as fasteners, but there's a much bigger and important story here about screws were used in measurement to make those machines, and the pretzels, ultimately possible. Screws have been used in measurement probably much longer than you can imagine, and the story of how and what they unlocked with their simple helical magic is absolutely incredible. In a previous video, I already talked about Hero of Alexandria's incredible dioptra, which is recognized as using screws in a very clever surveying device, amazingly, way back in the 1st century AD. Also in that same video, I mentioned drawings of cannons from the 1480s which used screws to carefully regulate their firing angle. If you haven't watched that video, check it out. In the 17th century, in England, an important leap using screws for precision measurement was, yet again, not where you'd expect it, as in measuring the length of things, but in astronomy. In one of the world's happy accidents, around 1639, a spider crawled into William Gascoigne's telescope. The web that it spun in there was in just the right place between the elements, such that the spider web itself was in perfect focus, as well as the very distant objects he was looking at. This meant for the first time ever, an astronomer had a truly beautiful reference right inside his telescope. Gascoigne is credited with first creating something you may have used yourself, the telescoping sight. These were first used in telescopes, but had been adapted way beyond those. Then Gascoigne took it a step further and put a screw-driven measuring device inside his telescope. By turning a handle attached to a screw, he could move two vertical arms with very thin wires back and forth so he could measure the width of objects he saw in the sky. By also knowing the focal length to the object, he could calculate the size of objects with unprecedented accuracy. It was also useful for calculating angular distances at resolutions just not possible before. This was a huge leap forward in our understanding of astronomical objects, and Gascoigne, while not a household name, is recognized as having made significant advancements in astronomy thanks to help from a screw and a spider. In his screw-driven device, Gascoigne ended up using thin wires, not spiderweb, though later spiders would be farmed for exactly this purpose and used widely in telescopic sights because spiderweb is thin, strong, and resists change in temperature and humidity well, which is especially useful in long overnight astronomy viewings. And while it's easy to imagine how screws are important when directly used in measurement, like Gascoigne's telescope, they are also indirectly important as well. In the latter part of the 18th century, Jesse Ramsden was the preeminent instrument maker in Britain. The pieces he made are surely some of the best of the period. To solve a vexing problem, an award was offered. How to accurately mark out the dials on instruments, in particular the curved ones like on sextants. While there have been various techniques used over the years, they tended to suffer from a few different problems, notably being slow, error-prone, and expensive. I mean, how good is your instrument if the dial you're reading from isn't accurate? What was needed was some kind of machine that could solve all of these problems, and that's what Ramsden created. Building upon some previous work and taking it much further, Ramsden invented an innovative dividing engine, able to accurately and quickly divide a circle, such that a sliding scribe could make a very accurate line on the scales of instruments. It worked very simply. A huge 2,160-tooth worm wheel ran around the entire outside. A foot lever could be stepped on to rotate a worm screw 6 rotations exactly, which would be 1 degree. Then a scribe on a sliding sled could be used to mark the workpiece as it was clamped in the engine. This drove the price of marking out a sextant down by 50 times, and it made it more accurate as well. Ramsden won a prize for his engine, and as a condition of doing so, had to publish the plans for how to make it in addition to the very innovative screw-cutting lathes he invented to make it accurate. And I'm happy I get to share those plans with you. And so this design was copied and even improved upon, which means that suddenly there were many more instruments made that had much better scales on them. So in this case, you don't see the precise measuring screw in the finished project. It's not there at all, except as a core component of the machine that made your sextant more accurate and much cheaper. And this led to improved instruments of all kinds, which helped tremendously with navigation and other kinds of scientific instruments. And think how important that is. Whenever you can measure better, you can do just about anything better. And if you're thinking, what's Ramsden's dividing engine done for me lately? The dividing head that I have in my machine shop that I use to make the timing clutch for the Marble Machine X has a worm wheel inside of it that uses the exact principle, just in a more compact form. So Ramsden's basic design lives on. Then, allegedly in about 1776, finally, the first end measurement device that I know of using screws was created. I say allegedly because there is some doubt and research continues, but more on that another time. Supposedly made by one of the giants of the Industrial Revolution, James Watt, the man that greatly increased the efficiency of the steam engine, and then, even more importantly, set up a business with a partner to make engines for anyone who could pay. If there's any one person when you think Industrial Revolution, it's usually Watt. A couple years ago, I was privileged enough to travel to London to examine the micrometer firsthand and take it apart to help answer a lot of the questions about it. I have a whole video about that amazing experience that you should watch for sure. And at its center, as the main element, is a screw driven by a crank on the back. Cleverly, as the screw is turned, it slowly moves a sliding jaw forward in small amounts, and a high-resolution dial on the back allows for precise measurements to be read. The screw serves a second purpose, too, which is to also turn a worm wheel, which is a lower-resolution display, one line per complete turn of the wheel on the back. This way, between the two dials, you should be able to read both the number of turns and a high-resolution display of a partial turn, and this lets you calculate the measurement really easily. Keep this in mind, as we're going to see a refinement on this idea a little later. I love this idea so much I made a 3D printable version of it, and you know what? It actually works really well. Stick around to the end to find out more and how you can get the files. This micrometer isn't known to have any descendants. It's like it was made in a vacuum with no obvious device that inspired it and nothing known to have come after it. If Watt ever used it in anything, there's no record of it. Did this micrometer play a vital role in the precision of the creation or manufacture of Watt's famous steam engines? Or play none at all? We may never know. But if it did this screw, this very screw, contribute to the success of Watt's engines that powered huge factories, that generated vast fortunes and was a key trigger for our modern world? It blows my mind even considering it. So while we don't know if Watt's supposed micrometer played any role in the Industrial Revolution, we do know that without precision, his engines simply weren't possible. But we do know of one man and his inventions who, for sure, brought precision to the world and in a very meaningful way. And precision screws are a big part of that story. Enter a certain Henry Maudslay. Describing the full breadth of Maudslay's talents, inventions, and impact would take us all day. So for now, I have to just stick to one small part of what he is known for, measurement. An incredible precision freak. He had a particular interest in screws and worked tremendously hard to make them as precise as possible. Famously, in the display window of his shop, he displayed a single item, a 5-foot-long brass lead screw that was incredibly precise for the time and a statement no one else could match. No doubt there were other precision machines and screws made by others before Maudslay, but as far as I can tell, they were pretty isolated and in low numbers and for singular specialized tasks like clockmaking. While precision may indeed be the child of many parents, Maudslay took it all to a whole other level, and he started building true precision machines for industry at scale. With such an interest in precision and having harnessed the power of precise screws, it's no accident around 1805 he invented his own bench micrometer, with a very precise screw at its core, reportedly able to measure reliably down to 0.001 of an inch. Nicknamed after the highest appointed officer in Great Britain, the Lord Chancellor, Maudslay's bench micrometer was the ultimate authority and used to settle any dispute in his shop. And at the Science Museum, London, they have a bench micrometer made by Maudslay, which is incomplete but thought to be similar to his famous Lord Chancellor. And we can't talk about Maudslay and screws without also mentioning his famous screw-cutting lathe. One of the first screw cutting lathes. By using one master screw, he could cut new screws that could go into other precision machines, so the precision could easily be copied. Cleverly, different gears could be swapped between the master screw and the spindle so you could cut screws of different pitches as well. This lathe shows up in many of the history books about machine tools, often incorrectly described as the first screw cutting lathe, but we'll talk about the problems with that and screw cutting in general another time. But you don't have to look at it just in the history books. Amazingly, it's in the London Science Museum in the back of a display case, sitting there as if it wasn't one of the most important pieces of machine tooling ever made. Maudslay is famous not only for the work that he himself did, but also for incredibly talented engineers that he trained, and then themselves went on to do amazing things. Not only did Maudslay make machines that duplicated precision, but he himself trained many men that would go on to do it as well, sometimes at even greater scale, ever increasing the amount of precision in the world. One of them, Joseph Whitworth, is, again, someone we could do several videos on, and we will surely talk about him another time. In fact, a couple of years ago, with Destin from Smarter Every Day, I did a collab video with him on Whitworth to talk about one of the accomplishments of what Whitworth was able to do, supposedly measured to a millionth of an inch, in the 1840s. Check that video out. In an era where measuring to a 16th of an inch was considered pretty precise, this was light years ahead. He made a couple different versions of bench micrometers, but the most famous was a very clever device to take advantage of two different kinds of screws, the worm wheel and the conventional screw. Watch the video I made with Destin to find out more. Whitworth claimed his millionth machine could easily tell the difference in a workpiece just by momentarily touching it with a finger. And that was really the problem. Temperature. Could it really accurately measure to a millionth of an inch? Modern testing says no. And you can understand what Whitworth's problem was. He had no way to control for temperature. And without a thermometer at least as accurate as your measuring device, you have no way of knowing how accurate those incredibly small measurements are. Speaking of screws, Whitworth's influence over screws was so strong he was able to standardize them across all of Britain in 1841. In a world where just about every shop had their own standards for making screws and few were truly interchangeable, Whitworth's incredible manufacturing influence was able to unite the country behind his thread standards, and they would stay the standard for decades. Even while there were many other competing thread standards, over the years they would survive in some specialized areas even into the 1960s. While Whitworth's effort in his screw standardization was a success, his millionth machine didn't fare well at all. But someone across the channel around that same time was working on something to put pretty high resolution measurement into everyone's hands. Or, should I say palms, as in Jean-Laurent Palmer of Paris. Or Palmer for us English speakers. In 1848, the familiar hand micrometer was patented by Frenchman Palmer. The micrometer had finally left the benchtop and was now in your hand. This simple, relatively inexpensive device, first designed by Palmer, meant anyone could measure accurately to small amounts, though obviously in millimeters at first. One story I've read is the inspiration was to be able to measure a stack of thin sheets of metal and know the count really easily, much faster than doing it by hand. These devices are now so ubiquitous, who knows, maybe made in their millions by now, and are in machine shops everywhere. And my shop is no exception, used every time I'm in there making chips, even though this design is over 170 years old. The operation is as simple as it is clever, and is entirely based around a precision screw. I don't have time to go into how to use it or read a micrometer right now, but it boils down to this. Once the screw has been turned to the dimension you want to measure on the workpiece, you can read the full turns of the spindle on the sleeve, and then add the amount the spindle has partially turned. With a tiny bit of mental math, you can easily add the two together and get a really high resolution measurement really, really quickly. If you want to know more, I'll link to a video on how to read one. By using the screw in two different ways at once, first by how far it moves along the axis, and then by how much of a circle it turns, if you remember back to the Watt micrometer, This is the same idea, measuring full turns and partial turns, but in a much more compact and clever way. And this is the gift that Palmer gave us. A simple device in our pockets that allows us to quickly, easily, and reliably peer into tiny bits of measurement. As important and revolutionary as these Palmer micrometers are, the original ones are exceptionally rare. In fact, only four are known to exist, one at the Smithsonian, and three others in private collections. And here's me holding one of those four. What a privilege! A couple years back, I had the chance to examine one, and that was a real treat. The original ones were likely made in relatively low numbers, so how did they get to be made in their millions and start showing up everywhere? At the Paris Exposition of 1867, Palmer's invention was seen by the American industrialists Brown and Sharp, who promptly bought the patent, and a year later released their first sheet metal gauge based on the same design. And yeah, I got to examine one of those as well from the same private collection. Shout out to Tom at Ox Tool Co. for introducing me to someone with those historically valuable pieces. If you don't know Tom, check out his Brilliant Machining channel. He will surely forget more than I will ever know about machining, and I've spent countless hours learning a ton from him, and you will too. And so, micrometers like these became incredibly widespread, and often the first choice of machinist everywhere, in the old analog form, or now, sometimes the fancy digital ones. And over time, to get better and better measurements, the screws had to get more and more precise. The most precise ones I know of were able to make repeated and accurate measurements down to 20 millionths of an inch. Or, for my metric friends, that's about half a micron, which is absolutely incredible. That's about the size of an average particle of smoke from a purely mechanical screw. But then, in another revolutionary step, they were paired with rotary encoders and linear scales. Suddenly, the precision didn't just have to come from the screw, but from the electronics the screw was driving. No longer was it necessary to strive for near-perfect mechanical accuracy with the screw, which was very expensive and time-consuming. Now the magic could come from the electronics. And look what it did. In both the cheap version and the highly respected brand, which is even traceable back to national standards, so you know they're not messing around. For insanely small amounts of money, and under the right temperature conditions, of course, you can now get micrometers which can measure down to 1 micron, or about 40 millionths of an inch. And that absolutely blows my mind. And of course, electronics just didn't find their way into micrometers, but into all sorts of ways to measure, which we're going to talk about in an upcoming video. But in the centuries before we had help from electronics, measuring with screws was an incredibly important and influential part of everything industrial. I want you to pause for a moment and think about all of the screws used in measurement that we touched on in this video, which is only really part of the story. Like those pretzels we saw at the beginning. You don't see the screws of precision in the pretzels, just like you don't see them in all the things I just mentioned, but they're surely there, bringing precision to all kinds of things you would normally never think about. They're there, just sometimes invisible and in the background. So what do you think? Maybe I changed your views on how screws are used? Let me know what you think in the comments. The next stop in your journey is to hit the subscribe, thumbs up, and bell button if you like this. It's great to get that kind of feedback, and it really helps keep me going. If you didn't like it, give it the old double thumbs down. I can't stand advertisement interruptions or putting other people's words in my mouth, so I don't do mid-roll ads or take money from sponsors. Instead, I'm supported by the lovely people over at my Patreon who are helping bring more content like this. Would you consider joining us? With every video I publish, I also have a Patreon companion video that goes a bit further and has more detail on the things that I had to cut, or things that I found really cool but just didn't quite fit. And even if I don't publish a video on my channel in a month, I still publish a Patreon video with updates and show behind the scenes and more how I'm just putting all of this together. At most Patreon levels, with this video, people will get the 3D printable watt micrometer I showed in the video, and also Blender files with some of the animations I did as well. It's cool stuff, and there for you to play around with. As always, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.